Hi guys, myself Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs. So I hope that these students of SEBI grade are doing very well in their preparations, and those who wish to appear for RBI grade B, I would like them to start their preparations as soon as possible. The reason behind this is that you never know when the notification for RBI grade B will come out, and if it comes out suddenly, then you will be left with no time. So don't waste your time, guys. Just start preparing for RBI grade B, and those who want to appear for SEBI grade A, they are already preparing. So this series of morning days is going to be very helpful for those who want to appear for RBI SEBI NABARD examination. This is the phase 1 current affairs series, and I have brought to you very important current affairs for today. So let's begin this video. But before that, I would like you guys to subscribe to our channel and hit the bell notification so that you can be in touch with us and know about the latest updates. Also, you can join this Telegram channel to ask your queries and get them resolved on this Telegram channel. And the link of the Telegram is provided in the description box below. So let's begin with the video today. As I have not mentioned the table of contents because the questions are few today, and that's why I have not put the table of contents, and we will be quickly discussing the questions itself. So the first question is, recently Union Cabinet has approved to implement the Panchayati Raj system in Jammu and Kashmir. Under which act will the system be implemented in the UT? So you can see that in the options the act name is same and the years are changed. So this highlights the importance of remembering the year as well. So this is the answer. J&K Panchayati Raj Act 1989 is the answer under which the Panchayati Raj system is going to be implemented in the UT. Now guys, you should understand this thing, that why is it being implemented? The reason is that since independence till this day, Panchayati Raj system was not implemented in J&K. And that is why, in order to implement the Union Cabinet has approved this act and has approved to implement this act and the Panchayati Raj system. Now guys, do you know that Panchayati Raj system works on three levels? So it is basically a local system of self-governance. That we all know, right? So under this system, there are three levels. One is the village level, one is the block level, and one is the district level. So this is the basic level, level 1, this is the level 2, and this is the level 3. I know that majority of you would know the answer, but those who did not know, I hope that they have now known the answer of this question, that what is this local self-government, what is this Panchayati Raj system, and how many levels are there in this system. So what is the benefit of implementing this system? The benefit is that now the people of J&K will get this prerogative to appoint their own representatives at each level. So if the head of their community, or if the representative of their community is of their choice, then the people will get more empowerment, then they will get a greater representation. So that is the main idea behind launching this system in J&K. Now guys, do you know that through the 73rd amendment to the constitution in 1992, the Panchayati Raj system was formalized? So this is the minor fact that you should remember from the exam point of view, because you never know what kind of question can be put up from what kind of news. So there are chances that from this news, this question might come up in the examination. So you should remember this thing. Now here this news ends, and my question for you is that you have to tell me the governor of J&K. Governors are very important, especially when we are talking about union territories. So do mention your answer in the comment section, that who is the governor of J&K. So that was our first question, and this is the second question. Which state has topped in the anemia mukt Bharat index? So anemia mukt Bharat is anemia free India. So first of all, you should know that this index is released by Ministry of Health and Family Welfare in association with UNICEF. quite an important fact it is, so do remember this thing. Now, which state has topped in this index? It is Haryana. Haryana is at the first position and it has gained a score of 46.7. So, this is the score of Haryana in this index. Now, the total number of states that were assessed in this index were 29. So, this indicates that Jammu and Kashmir was taken as a state itself and not as a UT in this index. So, do remember this thing. This is very important. Now, we have discussed all the facts related to this index. Now, we should also look at the achievements of Haryana in terms of health. So, for the first time in the history of the state, Haryana has achieved a 93% immunization coverage. So, from mere listening itself, it is very evident how important this news or this fact is, that 93% immunization target has been achieved by Haryana. Well, that too for the first time in its history. So that's why this is important. The second fact that, or the second achievement of Haryana in terms of health, is that it has institutionalized 93.7% deliveries in the state. So this is how Haryana has achieved, Haryana has progressed in terms of health. And these facts are very important from the exam point of view, because they were highlighted by many news channels. That is why you should pay attention to these facts. So here this question ends, and my question for you is the CM of Haryana. So do tell me this answer in the comment section below. So now let's discuss the third question, which is a very interesting question, I would say. So which of the following institute has discovered the tuberous salivary gland? First of all, you should know that this part of human body, this organ of human body, was not known earlier. So this is the first time that a new organ has been discovered in this world. So which institute has done so? Which institute has made this remarkable discovery? It is Netherlands Cancer Institute. So during its research on prostate cancer, it has discovered a new organ in the human throat. So are you guys interested? Are you guys curious to know where this gland is located in the upper throat? Okay, I have told you that it is located in the upper throat. So let's have a look at the exact location of this tuberous salivary gland. So this is the exact location behind the nose and behind the mouth. So this is not very important from the exam point of view. It just intrigued me, so I thought I should also show it to you guys. Now, what is the purpose of this gland? This gland is salivary gland. Therefore, the purpose is same as of the salivary glands. It moistens the upper throat. So that's the purpose of this gland. And now my question for you is that you have to tell me the static facts related to Netherlands, capital, currency and PM. So these are the three facts related to Netherlands that you will be telling me in the comment section below. Next question is, which organization has released the global estimate of children in monetary poverty and update 2020? So this is a new report that has been recently launched. So which two organizations have launched it? It is UNICEF and World Bank. So the answer is option E, both A and C. How can you remember the organizations better? From the title itself. From children, you can easily remember UNICEF, and from monetary or money, you can remember World Bank. So this is how, from the title, you can remember the organizations releasing this new report. Now guys, do you know what is the main important fact that this report highlights? This report states that out of 6 children in the world, 1 is living in extreme poverty. So this is the tragic situation of the world, that 1 among these 6 children is living under extreme poverty. So this amounts to a total of 356 million children. in the world that are presently living under extreme poverty. Now, you would be thinking that I'm continuously using the word extreme poverty. So, what is the criteria of determining extreme poverty? So, extreme poverty is determined by this threshold, that if a household or an individual is able to earn this much, that is $1.9 in a day, then he is not living in extreme poverty. So these are some of the basic facts. Apart from these facts, there are other facts as well. So let's have a look at those facts. So in the first pointer, we have 356 million children who struggle to survive on less than $1.9 a day. So again, this is the threshold of determining the extreme poverty levels, and a total of 356 million children are living in extreme poverty. Out of these 356 million children, two-thirds live in sub-Saharan African region. So do remember this thing, that the proportion of children living under extreme poverty is highest in sub-Saharan Africa. Okay. Now, what is the second fact that this report highlights? Children are more than twice as likely to be extremely poor as adults. So the percentage of children under extreme poverty is 17.5% in comparison to the 7.9% in adults. The third fact is 50% of the global extreme poor were children even prior to the COVID-19 levels. So this fact is quite shocking, right? Because we live in our own cocoons only. We don't have that much idea about the world, about the sufferings of others. And these kinds of reports tell us what the real picture is in other parts of the world. So this shocked me really, that 50% of the global extreme poor were children only. And even before the COVID-19 pandemic that has erupted. So what is the next and the last fact of this report? It states that 70% of the children in extreme poverty had their households in agriculture, had their households working in the agriculture sector. So this is the situation of agriculture worldwide. Agriculture is the poorest field of livelihood. So these are the facts related to this report. I hope that you will remember all the facts. These numbers, these percentages are important for you to remember. So let's move on to the last question of the day. But yes, from the previous news, I have two questions for you. You have to tell me the UNICEF's headquarters as well as the World Bank's headquarters. So these are the two questions from the previous news that you will be telling me in the comment section below. Okay, so let's discuss the last question of the day. Who heads the IRDAI's panel on standard cyber liability insurance product? First of all, let's discuss what the purpose of this committee is, because otherwise it will keep intriguing you until I tell you the purpose. So let's first discuss the purpose and then we will be discussing the answer. So the committee has been set up in order to look into the ways to make cyber insurance easy for individuals and for establishments. At present, if any individual wants to take cyber risk policy, there are complex compliance burden and complex formalities that one has to undergo. And in order to simplify the process and to provide standard cyber products to individuals and establishments, this panel has been formed. Now, this panel will suggest recommendations in this regard only. So now, who heads this panel? First of all, this panel is of 9 members and it is headed by P. Umesh. So this is very important for you to remember, and these are the informations related to this news. I hope that you have understood all the questions that I have told you, and in case if you have any kind of query, you can ask me in the comment section below. And here, this session ends. I hope that you have really liked it. And if you have, then do subscribe to this channel and hit the bell notification. Thank you for watching this video.